All right, we're going to continue our examination of forms today. What are forms? Forms are a way that the user can input data that is sent to a web server that is used by server-side scripts to create a customized, or dynamic is another word for it, web page based on the user's specific request. We gave examples of this. Something like logging into Canvas is a form, right? There's two places where you put in your user ID and your password. You click a button, then it logs you on. If provided that your information is correct, of course, because if your information isn't correct, it doesn't log you on. And when it logs you on, what it does is it creates a web page just for you. In other words, it shows your classes. It doesn't show anyone else's classes. It shows if you've got an email, and so on. So it's customized to you. And because you're students in this class, you only have student privileges in this class. So you can do what students are allowed to do. Whereas when I log on, I might see the same class as you, but I could do more because I'm the instructor of the course. All right. So the idea is that it makes a page custom for you. And that's not done through plain old HTML. That's done through what's called server-side scripting, which we do not study in this class. But we do study the first part of it, the HTML necessary to make a form that we can use to send data to a web server. And because we don't study it, we're using other people's scripts. And the script that we're using in these previous examples were we did a mix of, I did some with the Bing search engine, I did some with the Google search engine, the Google Advanced Search. So let me pull up the example we had last time. Take a second to review it, and then expand upon it. Sit and stare at a blank screen for several hours. And the form consists of two text boxes, all right, one for the search and one for the language. Actually, we changed this to do search through Google, so I'll have to change that title, all right. Two text boxes are for the user to enter in their data, all right. And then we have a language text box. And so if we're going to do a search for HTML, but we want the language to be French, I think we type in lang fr, if I remember right. Does anyone remember?
Might be an underscore.
Might be an underscore? Okay. We'll try that. Just the fact that we don't remember it is a warning sign, right? Because if we don't remember it, and I was explicitly talking about this to study how it works, then how's a user going to have a fighting chance of knowing how to format that entry, right? So right off the bat, that's a sign that something might be wrong. So I click go and I do the search, and, well, that worked. Yay. All right. Now let's say I did forget, which I did, and I used the dash. Doesn't work, because it doesn't know lang dash fr, it knows lang underscore fr. All right? So, the point is we have to have a very specific input for this to work. So let's go and let's look at the code, because that's the issue we're going to address today. But before we do that, I'm going to review this. And I want to review a couple of things, three things about this. First of all, the whole form apparatus and how that works, the styling of it, and the accessibility things that we put in. First of all, remember the form tag goes around all of the input stuff, all the stuff that's going to get inputted. So if you had a form where you entered in your name, your address, your phone number, your email address, your credit card number, all that sort of stuff, there probably still would only be one form tag, right? It's possible for a page to have more than one form tag. For example, I've seen some pages that said, well, if you already have an account, here's what you type. You type in your username, password to log in. There's a button. If you don't have an account, here, enter all this information in. And it would have like user ID, name, password, and so on. So you could have a form that did two things, but that's like having two different letters that you could send a server. One is your login credentials, one is your registration credentials. So the form tag goes around everything that we're going to send to the server. The action and method are important. The method specifies how we're sending it to the server. And for this class, we can just use get. And the reason we're using get is that it sends it on the query string, which means it's visible. So, for example, if I type in that I'm searching for HTML and my language equals Spanish. Notice we see up there the stuff that I entered in the form. AS underscore Q equals HTML. LR equals lang underscore ES. And then we even see the button that indicates that I pressed the button that said go. All right. So that's visible, and that'll help us with our debugging, all right, because we can look and we can actually see what's being sent by the server. So if the server doesn't process it right, maybe we're doing something wrong or we're not calling something by the right name, all right? For your homework assignment, I've supplied the name that you should call the things on your form, all right? So the action then is the name of the script on the server side that gets called. In other words, this is a code that is going to process the user's request. It's not a plain old HTML page, it's a server-side script. And a server-side script, if you remember, is a program that takes the input, takes other attributes of the request, and produces an HTML page. The difference being is that page is created on the fly by the program and it's customized for the user's specific request. So the pages that we did early in this class were static pages. So if I viewed them, if you viewed them today as opposed to last week, they would always look the same unless you manually went in and changed something. All right? Whereas the Google search script is a script that's dynamic. In other words, based on who is running it, where they are running it from, whether they're on a Mac versus a PC, what they put into those boxes, they're going to get a different result, customized for them. All right? So, the tags that I use input type equals text, and that's a plain old text box. Plain old text box being just a single line of text. All right, that we can put in. It has both a name and an ID, and generally we can make these the same. There's only one sort of exception to that where we don't make them the same, and that's a radio button. And they're used for different purposes. And unfortunately, you need two of them, all right? The name is used to send the data to the server. So name is AS underscore Q because the server requires that. How do I know that the server required it? Well, I did a little bit of reverse engineering. I did a Google advanced search, and I looked on the query string to see where my search term got placed in the query string, what it got called on the query string. The ID is used in conjunction with the label. Label 4, this corresponds to the ID. And that is simply to provide some accessibility. In other words, people that can see, don't even think about what label belongs to what text box. It's what's right next to it, right? But if you can't see the screen, and a screen reader is reading you the screen, then that can be harder, all right? And the label provides a little tip for people that are accessing this via a screen reader. All right? A form really is simply an unordered list of form items. So I put it in an unordered list. First form item, this form item, and so on. And by styling it correctly, I styled it to make it look like a neat little form, like this. All right. So, there we go. All right. Now, any questions about that part? Now we're getting into the other form controls, because as we see, a plain text box is not good, because the users could type anything in there, right? And if you type anything in there, then you might get the right results, you might not get the right results, all right? So, what we're going to do is we want to make sure that instead of free form typing in something, we're going to give the users a list of options. Now, we're not going to do all the languages because there's 100 some, right? But we could pick a handful of them. And how do we tell what the language codes are? We can go to Google and try their advanced search. Maybe. I never quite remember how to get to their advanced search, but I think it is like that. And notice again, there are hundreds of them. So we're going to pick a few. All right. Lang underscore ZH is for traditional Chinese. So Lang underscore ZH is for traditional Chinese. Lang underscore FR is for French. Lang underscore ES is for Spanish. And Lang underscore EN is for English. So there's four of them. And we could do as many of them as we wanted to. All right. We're going to start out by doing a drop-down box, just like the advanced search did in Google. And this is an example of a drop-down box where it's a single line. When you click the arrow, you see a list of all of your options. So you can't just type anything in. You have to pick one of those options. So that's what we're going to do, only we're not going to do it with all of these. We're going to do it with just a handful of these. So let me go in here. And I'm going to remove the input, and I'm going to put a drop-down. Now, a drop-down does not use the input tag. A lot of the form controls use an input tag, but the drop-down doesn't. All right? I'm trying to think if there's any other that don't. I think they most all do use the input tag. So, select ID equals LR name equals LR. So I'm keeping the same ID and name. I kind of have to, right? Because that's what the server's expecting. This brings up an interesting thing if you think about it. The server really doesn't care where the data comes from. In other words, we wrote this initially using a text box. Server didn't care as long as we got it right. We're going to change this to use a dropdown. Server still isn't going to care as long as we get it right. Later on, we're going to rewrite it as a radio button, and the server still won't care as long as we get it right. So the server just cares about getting its data identified and formatted the way that it expects. It doesn't care how it was entered on the form side. Therefore, you have flexibility to make the form make the most sense from your perspective and, more importantly, from the user's perspective. So when you're doing the pizza example, think if you were ordering a pizza. Would you want to have to type in the size of pizza that you want? Probably not, right? Because you don't know what the choices for size are at that pizza place. You know, do they have, you know, small, medium, and large? Do they have small, medium, large, and extra large? Do they have small, medium, extra large, and ridiculous? You know, who knows what they are? Is it something goofy like Starbucks where tall is small and, you know, who knows, right? The bottom line is, for something like that, there's a predefined list of things that you can choose from, and you want to make it easy for the user to pick them. So you wouldn't let them freeform type it in. You would instead use a dropdown, or as we'll see in a couple minutes here, use a radio button. So, the dropdown identifies that we have a list. And although there's ways to do it, by default, a list only allows one selection. All right. So if I change my choice, it gets rid of the old choice, and I have the new choice. Now, associated with the list is a list of options. All right. And I'm going to put language of English as the first option. And I'm doing that for a reason. I'm doing that because that's probably Google's default language. In other words, if you don't specify the language, it will probably give it to you in English, I would think. I don't know for sure, but probably. Now notice that there's two parts. There's two ways I'm saying English here. One way is I'm saying it with the word English, all right? And that is between the started and option tag. What's between the started and option tag should be what the user is going to understand. In other words, lang underscore en, maybe users will figure out that that's English, maybe not. That's not immediately apparent what lang underscore en means. I could see where it could be confusing. All right? But the word English, yeah, people should understand that, that means that it's in English. You're going to see this all the time in forms where there's two pieces that you're showing for each option. The one that the user is going to understand, and the one that the script is going to understand. Let me give you an example. Let's say you were going to pick, you were registering for a course for fall semester. All right? You know that you have to take the database course, let's say. So the dropdown might have, you know, database design and implementation. And you look and you say, yeah, that's the course that I need. The script, however, because it connects to a database and has to have things using the code that the database has stored stuff in, might have the course code, which is CISS-143. If the dropdown showed you CISS-143, then that might be confusing to you. You know, CISS-143, what is that? Is that database? Is that C#? Is that, you know, whatever. So The data is shown to the user in a way the data is understood, but behind the scenes, the value is also stored in a way that the script is going to understand. And this is an example. So the value of the option is what the script needs to do its thing, what the script's going to understand. And between the start and end option tag is what a human would understand, what the user's going to understand. So let me go make a few more of these. For French, Spanish, and traditional Chinese. So traditional Chinese was ZH. Spanish was ES. And French was FR. All right. So now, when I go and view this page, I don't see a text box again, I see a drop down. And I see a drop down where I can pick what I'm searching for. All right, so if I want to search for traditional Chinese and basketball, interesting, that didn't show up right. Let's try this. So that worked. Did I get the wrong code for traditional Chinese? Lang underscore ZH. Oh, wait a minute. ZH dash T. So I missed that part. So that told me the fact that I didn't get the results that I indicate to me. And let me look again. Was that an underscore or a... dash TW. I'll get it eventually. And there we go. All right. So, it's actually good I made that mistake. Teaching is one of those great jobs where if you make a mistake, you can claim that it was actually good because it shows students what happens when things go wrong, right? But if I get these things wrong, these values wrong, the drop-down will be understood by the user because I have the right names here, but the script isn't getting what it needs, so it's not able to process it correctly, all right? So it would be advisable if I was doing this to test to make sure each language that I have on the list worked. All right. Now, I'm not going to go and do all the languages, just in the interest of time, but that's how you would go and do all the languages. Is you need to know the code that Google that the Google script is expecting, and you need to know what's going to be understandable for the users to read. All right. Now, Dropdowns are particularly good when you have a long list of data. Like, I only have four things, all right? So I still could use a dropdown, but dropdowns are particularly effective when you have a whole giant list of things, like, like a whole list of 100 or so languages. Questions. All right, we're going to do the same thing with radio buttons. All right, so I'm going to, just to keep things simple, I'm going to create a second form on the page using a radio button instead of a drop down. Copy this form. Now again, normally you wouldn't have essentially the same form repeated twice on the page, but I'm just doing it for demonstration purposes. I'm going to change this a little bit. Radio buttons are, again, like the radio buttons in your car. You can't play two radio stations at the same time in your car, right? If you choose one station, the other station goes away. All right? So, code for radio button is like this. I have a label, just like I did with the drop-down. I'm going to have input. Type equals radio. Name equals LR. Remember, the name is what's going to be sent to the server. And we know from the previous example that the server is expecting the name LR. So we have to give the server a name of LR. All right? Here's where radio buttons are a little bit different. Because I'm going to make an ID LR English, or LREN, let's say. And why am I doing that? Well, I'm doing that because I can't give everything the same ID. An ID of LR. Remember, what is the rules of IDs? The rules of IDs are that IDs have to be unique on a page. Alright? So, I'll make it English. What the heck? And finally, I have to specify a value. And the value is what the server is going to expect. So the server expects LR underscore EN. I got rid of the label, so I probably should put label 4, and this is going to be the ID. So again, people that are visually impaired can get the tooltip, can get the tip from the browser, or their screen reader rather, telling them what that is. So I'm going to make a row for each of, actually I'm going to make them next to each other. So I'm going to put them as part of the same row, so they're oriented horizontally. If I wanted them oriented vertically, I'd simply make another LI with French and Spanish and traditional Chinese. But I don't. So I'll go and duplicate. Still going to be called LR, right? Because that's what the server's expecting. So the name for all these radio buttons needs to be the same. That's what makes them radio buttons. What's the characteristic of a radio button? The characteristic is that if you pick one, it unpicks the others. We'll see what happens if I don't unpick, if I don't have everything with the same name. But they all need to have the same name, and that name needs to be what the server is expecting. So let's go and add the other two. Okay, so let's review. I have a label that indicates what that means. That's tied to the radio button by the ID. They all have the same name, LR. That's what makes them act like radio buttons. All right. Without that, they're not going to act like radio buttons. And I'll show what would happen in a second here. The name, besides all being the same, is going to match what the server is expecting. So the server is expecting LR, right? So that's what we called the text box when we were entering it in on a freeform text box. That's what we call the dropdown when we use the dropdown. That's what we need to call the radio button group so that all the radio buttons send to the server the code for the language using the name for that code of LR. And then we have an ID, which has to be unique, all right? And what? Besides being unique is, ties it to the label tag, so for accessibility purposes, so people with a screen reader. Okay, let's save this. Yes?
All your labels are wrong. At the end of the label, they have LI.
Right, okay. Yeah, they pointed that out, but I had already copied it, I think, before. Thank you. Oh, that would have been fun trying to figure out. All right. So let's go and view this. Search. Oh, we have two forms here. I'm going to make it clear that there's two forms here. How am I going to make it clear? I'm going to put a giant, supersized border around them. How would I do that? Well, I want a border around the form tag. And I'm going to say border. Pixel black solid. I'm also going to give a margin bottom of 25 pixels. That'll just make sure that there's a gap between them. So I can clearly see that there's two forms. When I looked at that initially, it kind of looked like there was one form. All right. There we go. No doubt that there are two forms here. So I can search on this one. I can type in that I want HTML for traditional Chinese. And there we go. LR equals ZH-TW. Why didn't that work? Because it's not expecting lr.es, it's expecting lang.es and lang.zh and so on. Why did it give me the English? Well, that's Google's default. If Google doesn't get a language, or Google gets a language that you don't understand, it gives it to you in English. Alright, so now let's try. Both of these again, you would do it one way or another. You wouldn't do it both, right? You'd pick which one made sense. Now, for four of these, either the radio button or the drop-down probably would be acceptable. If we were going to do really all the languages, we would probably use a drop-down, because to use 100 and some radio buttons would be really confusing. All right, so how much space it takes up is a consideration when you're deciding what form control to use. Let's see. Questions about what we have?
Is there a way to, so you put a legend on the language maybe, and then line up those buttons vertically? Each other?
Yeah. In other words, what doesn't look good here is the way that they're spaced out. And I did that spacing out for this. The question of how you would do that, you would do that via, you could do that a number of different ways.
Okay.
All right. In a nutshell. One thing you could do it with is, I guess now's as good a time as any to do that. You could do it with a form set. All right? I think it's a form set. Field set.
I asked because I was trying to do that in the homework.
Right. And it was right.
Not so, working well.
All right. Let's try that. Let's try to do it with a field set. Thank goodness for Google. They was able to figure out that I did not want form set, I wanted field set. So that's cool. So let's go and do that. I wanted to talk about this anyhow. Now is as good a time as any. A field set is where I will have a group of the form, a group of related things on the form, where I want to separate the form sort of into subforms. A good example of that would be if I had a shipping address and a billing address. You know, where do you send the bill to? Where do you send the product to? So there's a shipping address and a billing address. So you might have, you know, city address, city, state, zip. You might have a billing one and a shipping one. So you might want to group those together and group them together so that it's obvious that these three things go together and these three things go together. Or, you know, maybe you have information about a person and information about the person's spouse, right? So you might have, for each of them, you might have name, email address, age, birthday, whatever. All right, but you'd want it clear that these three things are about the person, these three things are about the person's spouse. So in this case, I want to make it clear that this section is the language. So what I'll do is I will create a field set in the middle of my form. That will say that all these things relate to language. And I will put a legend on the form that says what the purpose of the form is. Now, I suspect I'm going to have to do a little bit of styling with this. All right, so I'll do this and then we'll play with the styling. So I'll save it and has those linked together, and all of these are the language. All right, so I have a language box and I could have as many radio buttons as I want. If I wanted to group them vertically then, I would simply make multiple LIs. The other thing I could do, if I wanted to, is I could lie and tell, say that within the field set, the input tag was a block tag. So I could do that via CSS. So 6 of 1, half dozen of the other. I probably would just make these their own LIs, but you could go the CSS route as well. Traditional Chinese, why is that? Well, because the label I've given a width to and traditional Chinese is bigger than that. So I could give a width of 150, let's say. Then I have it like that. So you can use field set anytime you want to group stuff together. All right, that's good for accessibility. That's good for styling purposes. I could change the border of that. I could change the size of the legend. If I want the legend to be bigger, or the font of the legend, or whatever, I could do that. Other questions about this? I'm going to go and finish up a couple of other form controls that really aren't relevant to the search, but you will probably need them for your assignment, and you need to know them. So I'm going to use the W3 Schools website for these. This shows you a text box, a form, the input, radio buttons we went over, submit buttons we went over, Action and method, we went over. Grouping items with a field set, we went over. The selects, we went over. Text area. Text area is where you have a multiple line text field. So it's free form. In other words, you can type anything in it, just like you can to a text box, but it's going to be multiple lines. So if we look at this, there's a text area. We say how many rows or columns, or we could probably better do that via CSS. And we, by giving the height and width, and we can put, we can put data there. So anything like comments, special directions, probably would be better in a text area. So text area is one of those other ones that is not an input tag. It's a special text area tag. There's a button, which we will talk about when we use JavaScript. Right now, we're not going to talk about it. They forgot at least a couple, or I missed them. Checkbox. Here's the other ones. Password is one. Say input type is password. Then when you type in something there, you don't see the answer. You don't see what's being typed in there. Type equals submit. Type equals reset. Don't use this one. All right. It's a reset button, and that clears out the form. Why do you think I say don't use this one? I say that because it will confuse people. They see a button, they think that it might be the submit button, and they might click on it, and it's really the reset button. The reset button clears out everything and lets you start over again. And the benefit that that provides is small compared to the trouble that it can cause by people accidentally clicking on it. How do you search for classes here? My campus?
Yeah.
They used to have a problem with the submit button and the checkbox here. That's not what I want. If I log in, it's going to log me in as an instructor. Does anyone want to log in real quick? Go ahead. Thank you. Alright, so let me search for classes. How do I... Student Center? Okay. Apologize for that information being shown. Where do I
send money?
Request?
There's a checkbox at the bottom there. That, yeah.
Information has been verified. Okay.
And then that.
Okay.
You have a schedule plan now. Or search for.
Okay, search for classes?
The green box.
Okay. Search for classes. There you go. I apologize for that. All right. Notice what we got here. Perfect. This is still a problem. I can go in and I can put all these criteria into search. So I can say that, all right, I want to schedule for fall. What do I want? I want CISS classes. I want 200 level classes, so greater than or equal to 200. My course career is I am an undergraduate student, and I am only available Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, all right? And I could go through all these things, and I could be ready to submit. Instructor's name begins with, so you can search for classes that I teach. It doesn't allow you to search for classes I don't teach, which I'm surprised, all right? But I could go through all that process and be ready to do a submit and casually, not looking, go and click this. What is this? This is a reset button. It's the first button. So human nature is, well, that must be the most important button. That must be the button to do the search. It's the biggest button. So your eye is drawn to that. Now, you might notice that the search button is green and the other one's blue, but I don't know, does green mean search? I guess sort of green means go, but it's not real obvious. So I could very easily go enter all that information and click clear, and the form laughs at you by clearing out all those fields, and you have to go and re-enter that again. So yeah, maybe once in a while it's beneficial, but it causes far more trouble than it's worth usually. If I wanted to have a clear button here, first of all, I would get rid of the clear button. I wouldn't have a clear button. If someone told me I absolutely had to or I'd get fired, put a clear button on this page, I'd make it small, I'd make it the second button, and I'd make it spaced away off to the side so that it wasn't obvious. I'd have to submit a big old button this big so you couldn't possibly miss it. And I'd have the clear button, a tiny little button next to it that, like, yeah, if you really needed to do that, you could press clear. All right? We'll finish this up on whatever our next meeting is, Thursday. Thank you.